It's time, and let me introduce the person who started working with design. As I remember, you told me in my email. So he started to work with design in early 90s. Yeah, just imagine someone of us just hadn't been born this time, and we didn't realize that we're going to be designers also. So, Lutz Schmid, hey, give the best and the loudest applause to him. Okay.
So, my pleasure to be here again, and this year with an exciting topic that matters to all of us. It's actually pretty basic, but nobody really talks about it, and actually I didn't want to talk about it either. I proposed a different talk, and then Julia said to me, well, your talk is really nice, but no, maybe you could talk about where the ideas come from. I said, well, actually that's a good idea. Talking about where the ideas are coming from, because I have actually no clue. They're just appearing in my head, and I'm quite happy about it. Sometimes they're not appearing, and I have no clue why. And then there are some things you can do, but you don't know why they work. Yeah, that's a good reason to talk about creativity. And I was staring at my screen. I needed a title for it, because it was very close. Yeah, that's a good title for a talk. Very positive, promising. No. Ah, Muses Kisses, exactly, yeah, now I have a great idea. Blank screens and Muses Kisses. That doesn't make sense at all, and screens doesn't sound good. Then I forgot to tell them that I changed it again, so the talk is called Blank Paper and Muses Kisses. That's very important. And eventually I stopped procrastinating on the title and was actually working on the talk. This was the epitome of procrastinating for me. So, anyway, I want to talk about creativity, the thing that happens in our brain, the thing that we use daily as designers, because we are constantly asked to come up with creative ideas, right? So, muses are godlike beings that come from somewhere, kiss us, and then there are ideas in our head. It's an old idea coming from the time where he was living. Anyone knows who that is? Archimedes of Syracuse. You maybe know his story, or his most famous story. When he was sitting in his bath, thinking about a problem that the king asked him to check if the new crown of the king would be of pure gold, but without scratching the crown, of course. So, and then you suddenly had the idea how to solve this. Shouted, "Eureka, Eureka, I got it! Finally, the spark, the muse had kissed him." And he was so excited that he jumped out of the bath and ran bare naked across the town to tell the king about his findings. And as old as the story is, it's kind of the cliché, iconic idea about creativity and what is sometimes expected from designers. And this is why creativity is kind of a mystery. You give something to them and suddenly they shout and then they have a brilliant idea. But there's a lot of things going on, and I will explain what is going on. But before we go there, there's an important question. What is actually a creative idea? Well, creative has two major aspects. First, something must be original. That's the easy part. And this is what we usually understand when we are talking about creativity or something. But something is only really creative if it is also appropriate to the problem, to the task. If, for example, I would be tasked with cooking for my family and coming up with a nice chainsaw and prepare it for dinner, that would be very original as a dinner, but nobody can eat a chainsaw, right? So it would be very inappropriate. And nobody would say, well, that was a creative idea. So when we are talking about creativity, it's also about originality and appropriateness as well. That's kind of important when we discuss this. So now we got this, we can go out to the next moment. Who's a creative person? Oh, nobody. Oh, that's why you're here, right? You want to learn to be creative. Ah, I got it. Okay. So actually we are all creative, and we are creative all the time. in the 1990s, a guy I can't even pronounce, so I give him the name soon, came up with the big idea of little creativity and big creativity. Little creativity is the everyday things, like when you're preparing tea and you're out of tea bags and you start to improvise because you want tea. The improvisation process is a creative process. It's a small idea. It's probably not world-changing, but it is something for you, and it is something new, and it is probably appropriate because you want to make tea. So every time when we create something little what wasn't there before, we are actually doing a creative task. And then, of course, there's the big creativity, the world-changing things, the world-changing ideas, Einstein, Pablo Picasso, all these fantastic names we know and their works. And yeah, this guy came up with this. I can't pronounce it. I won't even try. Yeah, you can, I bet. So, happily for me, some years later, Kaufmann and Beghetto, that I can pronounce, came up with the idea to extend this concept of small everyday creativity and the big genius creativity, and added mini creativity and pro creativity. Yeah, and this I want to introduce to you because this is quite interesting. So we already talked about everyday innovation, the little C creativity. This is what actually happens, and this is what you can check for yourself. If you think you're not a creative person, check your daily routines where you not only where you stopped being on the routine path, but created something little. Yeah, these are creative moments, and you can get a sense of, I got it. If you improvise and you solve a problem in a new way, that feels really satisfying. So take this moment for you and keep it because it feels nice. And when you're feeling good, what is actually a very important thing, you're more likely to be creative. First hint. Grumpy people are not creative. So then there is the mini-C creativity, the transformative learning. And this is an important one. Transformative learning means that you not only read something and then you have the knowledge in your brain, but you actually start playing around with new input. For example, children learn something, see something, and then take it over and play with it. And the actual playing process, creating something on their own from what they have just learned. Or for example, my boys really like to play with cardboard boxes. When we get a package, they get the cardboard box, and the next week is settled. Why? Because they find 100 ways to play with the cardboard box. And they play around with this, and they evolve their world while playing around. And this is also something what we are constantly doing and what actually is proven to be the better way of learning. Just putting knowledge in your head doesn't do anything, not really. Using, applying the knowledge, adopting it, this is actual learning. And this is also a creative task, of course, because you are creating something in your head. An example would be also when a child starts playing around with colors and suddenly figuring out that when you mix colors, you can create new colors. Well, for everyone here with a visual education, that's simple, of course. But for a child, figuring this out on its own, that's a fantastic moment of creativity. And then we are coming to the professional expertise. When we are doing our job, there are a lot of knowledge we can gather. We work together with colleagues, learn from them, all of these methods, techniques, all of these things. But then there's the moment where you think, wait, couldn't we use this method and this technique and combine them and make it better for this specific case? Could we improve our methods here? This is professional expertise. It's based on all the knowledge of the domain you're working in, and you are evolving your own work and probably sharing it at a conference like here and giving it further. And this is also a creative process. And especially in design, where we are constantly asked to solve novel challenges, we constantly adapt our techniques and methods. Yeah. Permanently. We don't just do the thing we did last year, today. Think about how you worked 1 year ago. Think about how you worked 5 years ago. Completely different. And this is also creative. But there's one side thing I wanted to mention. When we are talking about our work and all of this, we are actually standing on the shoulder of giants. All the achievements of mankind, every cultural thing, every technology that was invented before us, that we take as a given, is what we are standing on when we are evolving further. So we should never forget what was in the past, because what was in the past is the thing that heightens us, that gives us the chance to get even further. So knowing your domain, knowing a lot about history, is actually a quite good thing if you want to be creative, because you need some inspiration, right? So, and finally, of course, there's the big C, creativity. This is Pablo Picasso stuff. And you all know this. But there's an important aspect of creativity that isn't mentioned before yet. Who knows Pablo Picasso? Okay. Who knows Albert Einstein? Okay, who knows Johann Sebastian Bach? Okay. This guy, right? So, Johann Sebastian Bach, during his lifetime, was a very recognized musician and conductor. But barely anyone knew that he was also a composer. His children were famous composers, but not him during his lifetime. And only 80 years after he died, his works were discovered, and he became that famous composer we all know today. And it could have happened that we all wouldn't know about his genius and his great composings by today. He was a very genius and creative mind, but without recognition, it wouldn't be there. So when you have a creative idea, share it. Otherwise, it will just vanish. So I talked now a lot about the things, what might be creative or where when you can be creative. But let's get to the point, how does creativity actually work? So this is now the neuroscience part of this lecture. I'm not a neuroscientist, but I've read a lot of books in the last months about neuroscience. So if there's a neuroscientist here in the room, please correct me later after the talk. So, in our mind, we have different networks and processes that are used for different things, and these are key processes that are related to creativity. I don't explain all of them. This is something you can easily look up. There are big books about it. But I want to give you one example. Conceptual expansion. What does that mean? That's an egg, a chicken egg, to be precise. Now, I'm not asking if you know what a chicken egg is. But think for a moment about the concept of that egg. What makes that egg an egg? And now I would like to ask you and invite you to think about, or you can also take notes or scribble something quickly, imagine a new egg. Take the egg concept and expand it. Think about a new egg from a new species, from, I don't know, different environment needs. Try to imagine a different egg, a new egg, an egg that doesn't exist, a fantasy egg. Hello? Could you raise a hand when you have an image in mind of an egg? Yeah. Okay. That's nice. It's actually quite complicated to just jump there and say, well, now think about a new egg. We need to get this done before tomorrow. So, but some of you managed, and that's good. Now let's make it a little bit more complicated. I want you to repeat this and come up with another new egg that hasn't been there before. Think about it. Try to think about this egg, this new egg, a fantasy egg of a new species. Maybe some that never existed. Hmm? And anyone new egg? Really? That's good. Okay. You overcame the knowledge constraint I created here. Because probably most of you know Game of Thrones and the dragons here. And I was really distracting you with that. And probably if you now have an egg in mind, it's probably this one. No? Ah, damn it. In the test run, it worked. Okay. But it could have worked. Because when you know the series Game of Thrones and you know the dragons, you probably also know the egg. And getting tasked with creating a new egg, but in the same time see Game of Thrones, and you probably liked Game of Thrones, and Game of Thrones is important to you, this knowledge, this image, is just blocking you. Important takeaway here, the next time you need to be creative in your job, be careful with the competitor's benchmark and looking at other people's stuff. It could be in the way of your own creativity. So, now, I want to try to bust a myth. When you start reading about creativity, you quickly reach information about the left hemisphere people and the right hemisphere people being more the analytical guys and more the creative maniacs, and we are dominated by either the left or the right brain half. That's silly and wrong. The good news is we use our whole brain all the time. So whoever tells you that you're only accessing parts of your brain or that you're dominated by left or right, it's just all wrong and just forget it. What is interesting here is that there's something that is called novelty routinization. Usually we don't know when we get a new task. Actually, our right brain half is very sorry. Is very. Oh, come on! Now I'm stuck. Okay. Yeah. Did I mention that I'm not a neuroscientist? Okay, so what is here interesting, we are constantly forced to solve novel situations. This is actually true that our right half is quite important for that. But when we are getting used to something, the same task moves over to the left side. So depending on what you have done, what you have experienced, you either use your right, most of your right, or most of your left part. So saying, and even creative processes, especially in your job where you're trained at, you probably do with your left half mostly, even if the common myth says left is for analytics and logic. But let's jump and get over this, what I can't explain so properly. What is way more important is that there are two networks in our brain that actually are kind of the operating system. So the central executive network is the one that jumps into when there is a task. Something comes at you, a question, a task, problem to solve. The central executive network takes it and tries to solve it as fast as possible and put out an answer. Of course, could be very critical for survival to give out an answer as much as possible and not so much about novelty. And then there's the default mode network. That's kind of a little bit more the thing that thinks about your future, your personal awareness, and all of these things, and it is more or less self-driven. We can't really decide what the default mode network works on. Oh. Bad thing, the default mode network is the one where our novel thoughts are coming from, where the innovation comes from. So how can we be novel and innovate something, what is important for creativity, if we can't control the default mode network? We can't reach this directly. We can't make a conscious decision to be creative. So the important fact here is salience, the importance of a task. We have a third network, the salience network, and it all looks like this. And the salience network kind of decides how important the task is and which network of the brain is tasked to solve it. So the default mode network might get a kick from the salience network when our central executive network can't come up with a good idea because lack of knowledge or the situation is new. And at one moment, the salience network also gets to the default mode network and say, well, you were idle all the time. Could you please come up? We need this novel solution here, probably. Yeah. And this looks then here. There are studies on creativity where people's brains are scanned. And you see here, there's a high creative network. By the way, the left L and R is left and right hemisphere. You see, we always use our whole brain. So depending on where you are, depending on how salient a task for you is, your salience network might kick in and say, okay, let's do this and use everything. Be creative and create this great spark. But it might come in different shapes, to say so. This is a guy you probably don't know. This is August Friedrich Kekule, a German chemist. He was the one that came up with the description of the benzene and revolutionized organic chemistry with it. And legend tells that while he and many of his colleagues were struggling to understand benzene and the ring form of it, that he had a vision or a dream of a snake biting itself into its tail, forming a ring. And from this thing he was inspired and had the idea to formulate this theory that became proven and true. So even for a scientific mind, highly analytical, it was the vision of a snake that made him discover one of the most important chemist mysteries back in the time. So that's more or less about the brain. I'm sorry for the interruption in between. There's way more to read about, and it's actually really, really exciting, even if it's scientific stuff. I recommend going deeper into it. The interesting question here is, what do we need for creativity? No? So now we know how our brain more or less works, that we need to somehow kick our brain into creativity. How can we do that? And there are four P's of creativity. Process, product, person, place. Process is quite easy. For example, very old, Graham Wallis, 1926, nearly 100 years ago, came up with the process of preparation. You need to analyze the situation, you need to have input. Then your brain goes into incubation phase, that's in the subconsciousness. And suddenly, an idea illuminates, and your brain then verifies if this is actually a good and creative idea. While this is very tempting to believe that, and it's very commonly used by creativity and innovation trainers, there's no scientific proof that this is actually true. Well, it seems to be that the gene flow model that I introduce you now to is way more accurate. We have product constraints, like the input, as before. And then our brain starts to generate pre-inventive structures. That means building the necessary network to handle this. Our salience network tries to, okay, we need this, we need that, and connects everything and creates small bits of that might be a good idea. Then our brain starts to explore and interpret these bits and say, oh, is this actually a good idea? No. And it's all subconscious, so you don't recognize this. And at one point, the brain might come to the conclusion that that's a too broad answer and asks, could you please create some more focused things? Or, well, no, this doesn't fit. Could you create something bigger and expand the concept again? And of course, we can constantly get insights. And somehow in there, suddenly, the salience networks decides to bring up one of these solutions to our conscious mind. And this happens all the time, permanently. It's not a linear process. It's more like chaotic. Okay, product. Make this fast. First, we have the thought in our brain. The thought, without being communicated, just remains there and will die there. So when it is communicated, it becomes an idea in the room. You share it with others. But we all know an idea is nothing worth if you don't embody it in a product. So for actual successful creativity, you need to embody the idea somewhere. Remember Bach, who wrote a lot of stuff nobody recognized? Yes. So that's important. Don't stop with the idea. Then we have the person. I like the sentence so much. You can read it faster than I can speak it. And I thought, yes, that's me. And actually, these are things that we are asking from all designers, right? So if we can identify with these things, then we are very good bound to be also creative persons. Then, of course, there's something, it seems to be related with, to your IQ. People with a low IQ might not be very creative. If you have a high IQ, it's not necessarily that you're also creative, but it seems to be something that you need to have in high IQ. And then there comes the last thing, the place. The surroundings. On a macro level, it's the society you're living in, the culture you're living in, the economical stability and all of these things. Because if you're constantly thinking about how to pay next week's rent for your flat, your mind is pretty busy with this thought and you might not be very creative. And the same is also true on the micro level. These are some aspects that people found in research to be crucial in work environments. You need a challenging job. If your job is boring and routine, you will never spark your creativity. Why should you? You need the freedom to decide how to solve tasks. Because if you're bound to fixed processes, how will you ever be professionally creative? How can you ever try and experiment? You need the appropriate resources, of course. And the more and more important, our very specialized world, teamwork. The view of someone else with a different education is crucial to the creativity, the discussions you might have that spark something, things you can't think about because it's not your part of the expertise. And then the encouragement of your boss. If your boss doesn't like new ideas, you probably won't have some. And the general support in the company, of course. That's kind of the final one. And this is Charles Darwin. You also know him, father of evolution theory. When he did his expedition to the Galapagos Islands, he wrote down a lot of stuff and brought specimen and all of this. And he had everything in place for the evolution theory, but he had no clue then. Only when his father, after he returned, accepted to finance and found him the further research and give him the chance to do so, he finally managed to write down his evolution theory. So without all the freedom and all the support he got, we might never have gotten his evolution theory then. And this, by the way, is one of his notes and probably the first evolutionary tree that he has written down. Yes. That's about creativity. I know, this was a lot of stuff and very short, but I hope it gave you an idea about how you might want to change your behavior or what you want to look at to be more creative, and that it's actually not a miracle or something, but just brain works. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So,
and
thanks.
I know that I'm late, I'm sorry.
No, you're just right in time. So I just wanted to say that it seems like you have received a lot of muse kisses, right? While creating your presentation. That's awesome. Thank you so much. So it's time for your questions. I know you have ones.
Thank you very much. You spoke of creative freedom closer to the end, like you need to be free with your, I don't know, like to be creative. But also there is a thought that a limitation also sparks or boosts creativity. How do you think those two go together? How they can coexist? Is true? What do you think about the second one?
Well, one is the freedom of choice, how to approach a problem. And there you should be kind of free. What you mean is the limitation of something like a resource when you need to improvise, for example. And this actually goes along, because if you would be bound to prepare your tea as all the time, because this would be a requirement, but you don't have have the means to prepare it, you can't prepare tea. You need the freedom to improvise, and you come up with a good idea based on what you have available. And this is why limitations might result in bringing up new ideas, because the old ways doesn't work. But then again, you need the freedom to do it differently. Right?
All right, thank you.
So, thank you for the question.
Oh my God.
Hi. I'm a product designer, and I think most of us here are product designers. And so we create interfaces, and I do think that creativity is important for us, but also we have to use standard patterns. And yeah, and where's the edge between creativity and ruining patterns?
Well, the interesting question here is, what do you need? Of course, when you're creating complex interfaces, you will eventually come up with patterns, routines and standards, because you don't want to invent everything all the time. But then but to get there, you need to be creative and create the patterns. So it's a question of evaluation if something that you already have fits the problem. And this is also an important process, or if you need to be creative and come up with a new solution. That's part of the design process. And this is partly also what our brain does. First, our brain tries to solve the problem with already existing knowledge, because our brain is really, really lazy. And being creative is really, really a tough task. So if there's a quick answer, also our brain just gives out a quick answer and then checks if it's okay. Yeah, so and only if we force it, and now we need something new, or if there something is new from coming to us, only then we start to be creative. And it's not bad to not be creative and just solve something with only knowledge and only existing things. If it fits the problem, that's fine. So if the next time when someone says, so now be very creative, solve that problem. Tell them, well, we don't need to be creative. We have a good solution at hand. It's here. See? So, and that's okay. We don't need to be creative all the time, but we can. That's the great thing.
Thanks. So, yeah, it seems we have three more questions. I saw the hands, but we have no time. Sorry. So you're going to go and answer them on a...
Yeah, I'll be around the whole day. So
yeah, thank you
very much.